Hello, welcome to Bite Size Med. This video is on the functional histology of the thyroid gland and how the thyroid hormones work. The thyroid gland is this lobed endocrine organ that sits in the neck. Its job is to synthesize and secrete the thyroid hormones, which have effects on a lot of organs in the body. It also produces calcitonin, a hormone that plays a role in the regulation of calcium. This gland is surrounded by a fibrous capsule with connective tissue. The capsule extends deep into the gland as connective tissue septa. The septa divide the parenchyma into lobules. These septa are made up of reticular fibers. They have blood vessels, nerves, and lymphatics. The thyroid gland is very well vascularized, so it's got a rich capillary plexus, and these capillaries are fenestrated. The capillaries are how the synthesized hormones reach systemic circulation. So structurally, the thyroid gland has got lobules, and the lobules have millions of rounded thyroid follicles. The thyroid follicles are the functional units of the thyroid gland. In between these follicles is the interfollicular connective tissue. Each follicle is lined with simple epithelium and has a central lumen. It can be of different sizes. The lumen of the follicles is filled with colloid, a gelatinous, dense substance. This colloid is where the thyroid gland stores the thyroid hormones. The main component of colloid is a large glycoprotein called thyroglobulin, which is the backbone for the thyroid hormones. This is what is special about the thyroid hormones. Usually, hormones get stored in secretory granules inside the cell. But here with the thyroid gland, it stores the thyroid hormones outside the cell, in the colloid, until the gland is stimulated to secrete the hormone. So the thyroid hormones are stored extracellularly. The epithelium that lines the follicle usually consists of cuboidal cells, but that actually depends on the activity of the follicle. If it's resting or it's more inactive, the epithelium becomes squamous with a lot of colloid in the lumen. In a very active follicle, the epithelium would be more low columnar and the colloid becomes scanty. That's because the active cells take up the colloid in order to secrete the hormones into circulation. So when they're very active, the cells reach out and take up the colloid, reducing the colloid in the lumen. Less colloid, taller cells. But when they're not very active, they're going to store the colloid in the lumen while they rest. More colloid, flatter cells. This is where the polarity of the cell becomes important. The epithelial cells have an apical membrane that faces the lumen of the follicle and a basolateral membrane that faces the capillaries. These follicular epithelial cells are also called thyrocytes or principal cells, and the cells have tight junctions between them. The apical membrane has villi, which can form pseudopods in order to take up the colloid. The thyroglobulin that's in the colloid is synthesized by these cells. So their ultrastructure would be appropriate for that protein synthesis and secretion, with rough endoplasmic reticulum, Golgi apparatus, secretory granules that contain the thyroglobulin. Afterwards, they're going to take up the colloid and break it down in order to release the hormones into circulation. For that, they have lysosomes. The thyroid gland synthesizes the thyroid hormones, but there's another hormone that it forms too, remember? That's calcitonin. The thyroid follicular cells are responsible for thyroid hormone synthesis. The parafollicular cells synthesize calcitonin, also called thyrocalcitonin. These are the C cells, or the clear cells, or the light cells. Appropriately, their cytoplasm is pale. They are parafollicular, so they are located in clusters between the follicles or between the follicular epithelial cells on the basal lamina, but they don't reach the lumen of the follicle. Side note here, these cells belong to a group of cells called amine precursor and uptake decarboxylase cells, or the diffuse neuroendocrine cells. These hormones, be it the thyroid hormones or calcitonin, when synthesized, enter systemic circulation through capillaries. Now we'll see the steps of thyroid hormone synthesis in part 3, but what happens to them once they get released into circulation? The thyroid hormones are thyroxin, that's T4, and triiodothyronin, T3. They circulate either bound to proteins or not bound to them when they're considered free. They have actions on a lot of organs in the body. It's mainly free T3 that's biologically active and has effects on its target tissues. Structurally, hormones could be peptide hormones or protein hormones, amine hormones, or steroid hormones. The thyroid hormones belong to the amine category, but their receptors are located in the nucleus of the cell, like the steroid hormones. Peptide hormones usually have receptors on the cell membranes of target cells. But the thyroid hormones have to enter the cell to act on their receptors. Let's assume this is the cell membrane of the target cell, and this is the nucleus. I'm just going to use T3 to keep it simple, so I'm putting aside T4 for now, okay? These hormones have to enter the cell. They do that by diffusing across the lipid bilayer of the cell membrane or by using carriers. These transporters are the monocarboxylate transporters, MCT8 and 10. Once inside the cell, T3 binds to the thyroid hormone receptor. These receptors, like I said, are in the nucleus of the cell. The receptor forms a heterodimer with the retinoid X receptor. They bind to the thyroid response element of the cell's DNA. This is followed by transcription and translation, ultimately resulting in the synthesis of new proteins. And that's how it usually exerts its effect. But another way that thyroid hormones can work is by non-genomic mechanisms. This would not involve protein synthesis and would be more direct, thus faster. But most of the actions are supposed to be through this genomic pathway, which involves protein synthesis. The proteins synthesized are how the hormones have their effects on a lot of organs. Now, I'm not going to go into much detail on the individual effects of the thyroid hormone, because I find the best way to understand them is to learn the pathophysiology of the hormone alongside it. What helped me study it was learning what happens in hypothyroidism and hyperthyroidism, and then working my way backwards to understand the physiological actions of the thyroid hormone. But in general, physiologically, the thyroid hormone is needed for things like growth and bone maturation. It increases oxygen consumption by tissues, elevating the basal metabolic rate by increasing the activity of the sodium-potassium ATPase pump in the cells. It has a role in thermogenesis. It has effects on metabolism, like in carbohydrate metabolism. It increases gluconeogenesis in the liver. On protein metabolism, it affects both protein breakdown and protein synthesis. Similarly, on fat metabolism, it affects both lipolysis and lipogenesis. It's needed for the development and maturation of the nervous system. It also upregulates beta-1 receptors in the heart, increasing the effects of catecholamines, which act on those beta-1 receptors, like increasing the heart rate and stroke volume. So they do a lot of things. But now that we know how the gland is structured, and where those hormones that are formed are going to go, we have to fill in the gap. How do these cells form these hormones? And that's what we'll look at in part 3, the synthesis of the thyroid hormones. But that's some stuff about the functional histology of the thyroid gland and how the thyroid hormones work. I hope this video was helpful. If it was, you can give it a like and subscribe to my channel. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.